Jesus is speaking to his disciples who are really freaked out because Jesus has been talking about leaving them. I'm going to go away. I'm going to go someplace you cannot follow. You won't see me anymore. And so he's just really, they're afraid. Well, if Jesus is leaving, then where are we going to be? If Jesus is going someplace we can't follow, then where does that leave us in this whole thing? And Jesus said he was going to be delivered over to the scribes and Pharisees, and they were going to kill him. They just heard this kind of stuff, and they didn't really understand it yet, and they were scared. I think we would be as well. And so Jesus gives these words of comfort. He says in chapter 14, verse 1, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also." You know, for us living 21 centuries after Jesus said this, we see some of it, and I think it's very clear we understand pieces of it. But then I think there are other parts of it that we, if we have some background, understand what Jesus is saying even more. What I'm saying is there are insights that we can gain if we put on our Jewish glasses. So located in front of you, you'll find a little pair of Jewish glasses. If you put them on, and for those of you in the very front rows, they will fall down from the ceiling right now. Adults, put them on first for yourselves and then put them on your children, okay? So I've loved to point out these things, our Jewish customs, and I see the Old Testament as our family album, so to speak. Of course, we live in a new covenant, but you can't really appreciate, let's say that, you appreciate more the things in the new covenant as you understand some of the things in the old covenant. Would you agree with me? So I just want to point out, maybe you know this, but I think it's just worth reviewing. I want to think about some marriage customs of the first century Jews, and I think it will illuminate John 14, 1 through 3. So I'm going to tell you about the major steps of a Jewish wedding, ancient Jewish wedding, and actually, most of it applies today to a Jewish wedding. But the ancient Jewish wedding, first of all, before somebody got married, they were betrothed. So if you want to write that down, the first thing was they were betrothed. Now, this is something you really didn't have much to do about. Your dad, both dads would decide a lot of times before you even could, you know, have a choice yourself because you were so little, they would choose who you were going to marry. Now, I kind of think that's fun. As a dad, I think that's kind of cool to think that I would be the one that, you know. But that doesn't fly in our society, that's for sure. But from early ages, often, parents would decide that, you know, he should be my son. She would make a good daughter in-law, and so this would be the thing. So what would happen is, at the right time, the father would send his son to the father of the bride. So I'm going to call her the bride. I'm going to call him the groom. Is that okay? So just, they're not married yet, but we'll just refer to him that way. So the father of the groom would send his son to the father of the bride, and the groom would come with three things, okay? The first thing he would come with is money. Amen. Somebody who has a daughter getting married, say amen. Amen. He would come with money, okay? So that was very important that he would come with something in his hand, because in those days, you paid a price for your bride. So he would come, and it was important that he had that kind of finances and gifts for the father, bribe the old dad. You know, it might work. Secondly, he would come with a contract. It's called a ketubah. The contract would be something that listed all the promises that the groom made about how he would take care of his bride. He would care for her, the things he wouldn't do, the things he was promising to do. And often it's a long contract. And then it would be signed by the bride, by the groom, in the presence of two witnesses. And that happens still today. And that ketubah is a binding contract. The third thing, and, you know, the father would be looking at that to make sure, you know, all the provisions were there for his daughter and she would be taken care of. The third thing that the groom would bring would be wine, okay? He would bring wine. And that's because every holy thing in Judaism is sanctified by the drinking of a cup of wine. All the holidays, Jewish holidays, always begin with a cup of sanctification, the Kiddush cup. And this Kiddush cup, rather, is always drunk at the beginning of a holiday. The Sabbath always begins with that. You light the candles and you drink the cup, and the day is set apart. Passover, all these holy days are set apart that way. And so if a couple were going to become betrothed, what would happen would be the father and the groom would settle on a price that must be paid. There would be the contract signed, and then there would be the drinking of a cup of wine by the bride and the groom. And so they would drink that, and now the deal is sealed, okay? They are betrothed now. Now, betrothal is a step beyond our modern engagement. Don't raise your hand, but some of you were engaged, not to the person you ended up marrying. And see, in our society, engagement doesn't have quite the, well, we don't have at anything near the binding legality of the betrothal. So in order to get released from betrothal, you had to have a divorce. And if you were unfaithful to your betrothed, you could be stoned for adultery. Think Joseph and Mary for a moment. The Bible says that they were betrothed. Do you remember that? They were betrothed. Now we understand what betrothed means. Joseph had done all these things, and he was betrothed to Mary. But when he found out that Mary was pregnant and he knew he wasn't the one, he wasn't the father of the baby, then either she could have been stoned or he decided just divorce her quietly because that's the way he would get out of the betrothal. He wasn't going to make a big deal of it. But then, of course, the Lord said, hey, this child is of the Holy Spirit and you're going to be the Messiah's stepdad. Can you imagine that job? Really, you have the perfect kid, that's for sure. So the betrothal was a very important time, but the betrothal was also a time of separation and preparation. When you get engaged in our society, it seems like you get to spend more and more time together, right? Prepping for marriage. But in the Jewish wedding customs, you spend less time together. You'd be betrothed, and you were considered married, except you didn't consummate the marriage. And as soon as you were betrothed, the groom would leave, and he would spend time in preparation. So there is separation, and then he would start prepping. He would start at his father's house, building on an addition for his wife. And oftentimes, the families would live together, this extended family living together. And so he began prepping a place for his bride. Now, she had some preparation to do while she was separated from him. She was learning, you know, all the wifely skills. She was learning how to please him. She was learning what he really liked, you know, and they couldn't, you know, meet each other and talk to one another, so they talked through an intermediary. He'd send the message maybe through one of his good friends, and it would be delivered to her, and she would do the same through a friend, and the message would get to him. They didn't have email. They didn't have Facebook. Oh, Lord, how did they communicate in those days, right? So she, through intermediaries, she and he would be able to communicate with one another during this time of separation and preparation. Then the groom, working on the house, never knew when he was going to be able to go and get his bride and bring her home. You know, what some of us might do, guys, is we might do a rush job on the house because we really want to bring her home, right? So the father of the groom, he kind of oversaw the whole thing, and he said, you know, son, I'll be the one to decide when you can go and get her. So work hard. Make it perfect. Make it good. I'm sorry you skimped over here. Redo the drywall. You know, whatever. You know, so, you know, the dad was watching over the whole thing. So no one knew but the father when the groom was going to be told, you can go and get your bride. And she never knew when he was going to come for her. Now, having been involved personally in two weddings with daughters, and then one coming up with a son, I understand timing is really important. Ladies, what if you knew you were getting married? Yes, we're getting married. When? I don't know. Well, what's the date? I don't know. Well, how are you going to send out your invitations? I don't know. Well, see, everything depends on timing. When's the bridal shower going to be? I don't know. See, that would drive you crazy, wouldn't it? Instead, the bride, part of her preparation was she always had to be ready. The groom could be gone for up to 2 years. And during that whole time, she just had to be ready because she might have like half an hour's notice, maybe less, that he is coming and she is going to go with him to his house. Okay, so she'd have her wedding dress, she'd have everything there. But, you know, what a crazy thing. You know, she couldn't go to bed in curlers, you know, for sure, because a lot of times the guys would come at midnight. It was kind of just a, you know, I'm going to get her. We're going to come at midnight, you know, really mess life up for her. So a lot of times that's when he would show up. So, you know, can you imagine having to just take care of the mundane things, you know, helping cook, helping take care of the home, making the clothes, working, you know, maybe in the fields and all, and yet at the same time always needing to be ready. That's tough because I've got to do the things that are right and good to do, you know, but then I've also got to be ready because my husband might come at any time. Wow, what a being pulled both ways. So just always had to be ready. And her bridesmaids, you know, they had to kind of stay, they had to have their clothes right there and they had to be ready. And then the time would come when the father would say, son, go get your bride. No way! Go get her. So he would take some of his closest friends, and they would go, and they would start a procession, and they would go to get his bride. One of his good friends would lead everybody shouting, and sometimes they'd be blowing trumpets, and there would be this kind of, it turned into a parade as people would gather in and people would walk with them and they'd shout as well, the bridegroom's arriving, the bridegroom's arriving, he's coming, the bridegroom's arriving. And people, instead of honking their horns and all, they just kind of gather in the procession, make a lot of noise. And of course, either one of the bride's friends heard it or she heard it, and it was like, oh my goodness, he's coming. We've got to, thank goodness I'm ready, you know. Put all the clothes on, quickly do the hair, whatever else, you know, they did. And the nice sandals. Give me the sandals we bought 2 years ago, the special ones I'm going to wear. And so he would come for her. And this is interesting. The first time when they were betrothed, he went into the father's house and he, you know, paid the price and he signed the covenant and he offered the wine and drank that cup with his wife and then he left. But this time he's not going to go into the house. This time she goes out to meet him. And so she goes out, meets him, and then he takes her to the house. Shows her the room. They go into the room. Marriage is consummated. During this time, they have this huge feast. And all the guests and friends and relatives are feasting. They do that for 7 nights. Can you imagine? I've been to some pretty awesome wedding banquets. I would think it'd be wonderful if some of them went on for 7 nights. So this was this great celebration. At the end, the last meal, the groom would come out, present his bride, and then there'd be a great celebration again. So, okay, I get that. But Jesus, what does this have to do with disciples being discouraged? What does this have to do? This is crazy. You want to know? This is crazy. At the point where the groom had, he'd paid the price, he'd signed the contract, covenant, you know, he drank the wine just before he left, you know the words the groom would say? To his bride, he'd look her in the eye, he says, "Don't let your heart be troubled. If I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself so that where you are, there I will be also." Amen. Somebody say amen! Is that awesome? So this is telling me that the disciples are, Lord, you're going to leave us? You know, not really. And he says, "Don't let your hearts be troubled." And probably at this time they're saying, "Why are you talking like a groom?" Right? "Don't let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe in me. In my Father's house are many, many dwelling places, many rooms. If it weren't so, why would I tell you I'm going to prepare a place for you? But if I'm going to prepare a place for you, I'm going to return, and I'm going to take you to be with me forever." Now, I want us to look at this and see how it applies to us as believers. The Bible says that we are the church, and we are the bride of Christ. Now, I'm going to frankly tell you ladies, you might not understand that, but for us guys, to be told we're the bride of anybody is weird. How many guys would say amen to that? I mean, it's unspoken. It's unspoken. We never talk about this, but you're the bride of Jesus. Come on, is that weird? It's weird. It's okay to say it's weird. It seems weird because, you understand, right? But it's not going to be weird. Listen to this. You're going to be able to relate to the story here. And so the groom comes. We're the bride. The groom is who? Jesus. Jesus comes into this world, and he comes and he pays a price, right? He pays a price. He gives his life. That's the price that he paid for you. That's the price he paid for you. And then Jesus came with a contract. And the contract is all the promises, all the things that Jesus promises he will do to you, all the promises, "I'll take care of you, I'll love you," the things he won't do, "I'll never leave you, I'll never forsake you, I'll never divorce you, I'm always with you every minute, I'm going to take care of all your needs, don't worry." And Jesus signs that covenant in the upper room, and there's a cup, the cup that represents the covenant, the cup that seals the deal. In the upper room, Jesus says, as he takes the cup, "This is the new covenant contract." You might even say, "I'm stretching it tad, ketubah, in my blood, which is shed to take away your sins." You see, every time we partake of the Lord's Supper, we are reminding ourselves that we are married to Jesus, that we have said yes to Jesus, that we, like that bride who says, "Yes, I'll sign that agreement. Yes, I'll drink that cup with you," because that seals the deal. Now we're betrothed to Jesus. The promise is we're not with him yet because he's going to his Father's house, and there he is building a place for us. So Jesus came to this world. He came with the price. He came with the contract. He came with his blood, so to speak. And now he's left. He ascended into heaven, but he says, "Hey, I'll come back. I'll come back." And now we're in a time of separation. Jesus ascended into heaven. He's in heaven. We're here on earth. We're in a time of preparation. We know, you know, Jesus is preparing a place for us, but down here we're preparing ourselves to meet the Lord. He's coming back for us. So what do we learn? Well, we're learning to do the things that please him, right? We're kind of taking lessons in spiritual home ec, if you will. I don't know how else to say it. We're learning, what is he like? Tell me more about him. What is he like? What doesn't he like? How can I live? How can I learn to do the things that please him? That's what I want to do. And then we're in this awkward time of preparation where, you know, we've got to do the stuff we've got to do, the mundane things. And yet we've always got to be ready because the Lord may return at any moment, right? Can you relate to that? It's like, okay, I've got to move forward in my career, take care of my family. I want to continue my education. I've got to, you know, all of these kinds of things. Take care of the kids, take care of the house, you know, all of this stuff. Your car's broken down. You know, it's like, you've got to take care of these things God wants you to. And yet at the same time, God says, I want you to be ready because at any moment, the bridegroom could come for you. And of course, the time is going to come when the Father, remember they ask him, you know, when are you going to return? And Jesus says, no one knows except my Father who is in heaven. See, another little bit of this. So when the Father says to the Son, go, then Jesus comes and there is this great procession as he leaves for heaven. And suddenly, you know, it's going to be a surprise for us. No one knows the day or the hour, right? That's what the Bible says. It's going to be a surprise for us. But it says, the Lord shall descend from heaven with the shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God. That's marriage talk, too. There's that shout. The bridegroom's arrived. There is that trumpet sound. And we're like, oh, quick. Well, we don't have time to put anything on, do we? And that's why the Bible says, just be dressed ready for the Lord to return. Be dressed ready. And then the Lord will take us. He doesn't come to this earth. He doesn't touch this earth, rather. Instead, we go up to meet him. We leave this house, so to speak, and we go up to meet the Lord, and we go to be with him. And Revelation chapter 19 says that there is a marriage supper, and it lasts for 7 years. During that time, tribulation is going on earth. We are with the Lord for 7 years, and then we come back, presented with the Lord, and then, you know, the whole thing about coming to this earth and establishing God's kingdom age for 1,000 years on this earth. So Jesus is encouraging his disciples. Truly, I don't think the guys understood it right then. But John does, at the time he's writing this, we're not Jewish. And so we didn't see all of it. Are you glad to see this right now? Yeah. It's important. See, to look back and we see, oh, wow, now I understand. I have a hope. I am in a time of separation, but I'm also prepping, and Jesus is prepping. Every time I take the Lord's Supper, I'm reminding myself that Jesus made a contract, a new covenant, that Jesus came and he paid the price for me, and the price was accepted, and that Jesus' cup, I've participated with that cup with him. This is more than just a memorial, perhaps. This is really, I'm reminding myself that I actually and betrothed to Jesus. Can you remember that? Because that gives a whole new significance, I think, meaning to this. And even when, as we're looking forward to the Lord's return, we have this thought, don't we, of the Lord is coming back, not just impersonally, but he's coming back for you because you are so special to him that he came to this earth, sent from the Father. You were chosen. Why us? Why would we be chosen to be the one for Jesus? Grace. It's just grace. And it's amazing grace. It's wonderful grace. So disciples, troubled, worried, not sure what's going to happen to them. Jesus says, don't worry. You just trust me. And later on, they'll go back and they'll realize, oh, wow. He made a promise to us. He was betrothing himself to us. And based on the promises that he's made, based on those promises, he can never leave us. He can never forsake us. It's written down. Here's the covenant right here. Written down, signed, sealed by Jesus. And when you accept him, it's as if you're signing your signature on it as well. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much for this beautiful picture, this analogy between an ancient wedding custom and the promise and the reality of what Jesus has done for us and who Jesus is to us. Lord, we just thank you so much for this. We praise your name. And as we see how it influences the way we share communion with you, the way we live in this time of separation and preparation, help us to balance between what is mundane and what is eternally significant. And may we be found really watching for your return, prepping, stepping out of sin and the things that you don't like, and moving into the things, learning the things that please you. May we do that, we ask in Jesus' name. And everybody said, Amen.
Thanks so much for joining us online today. We are glad that we were able to bless you with God's Word. If you would like to help us continue this ministry, why don't you support the ministry of Calvary Community Church by clicking on the Giving tab.